Yesterday, I posted a video about my van losing heat because the temperature's getting cold outside, and a bunch of you had questions about winter van life. So I thought today we would dig through some of these questions and just talk about yesterday's video. This is something I've never done in this kind of real time before, where we took our topic from yesterday and made it a discussion today. So let me know what you guys think of doing something like this, and maybe this works out, maybe it doesn't. But while the topic is on our minds, let's talk about winter. You like my B-roll sequence? My videos wouldn't be my videos without a little bit of that and a little bit of music. It just wouldn't be Van City Van Life at that point. This is just all I could shoot from sitting here at my desk. All right, let's get into some of these. Prism Ward asks, frozen water in your water carrier. How long using your heater does it take to warm them up? Over here by my door, I have two large water jugs, and I think they're like 27 liters a piece, and they're over there by my door, and I've only had them freeze on me once. And that was a one-time experience that I talked about just recently in a video where my battery system failed in the batteries that I just removed out of my vehicle, and I lost my heater. So when that happened, it was minus 32 degrees Celsius outside, which meant the temperature inside of my van plummeted very quick, and water jugs froze. I couldn't get any water out. Cruz's water dish was frozen like half deep. It was cold in this van, but that was the only time. I never have water freezing problems because I control the temperature in here. And the only time I've ever had anything partially freeze is maybe a really thin layer of ice on the top of Cruz's water dish. If me and him are curled up underneath the blanket and it gets to minus 10 outside and we're super warm in the blanket and I don't notice that it got that cold, that's the only time I've ever had water freeze. But before I get out of bed, I reach over here, the button's right on the side of my bed there, turn on my heater, wait for the inside of my van to get to like, I don't know, 15, 18, 20 degrees Celsius, and then we get out of bed. So because I have control of the ambient temperature inside of here, frozen water is not a problem. But if you guys are doing winter camping, like they said in that comment, keep water bottles close to you. Like maybe fill up some bottles, bring them to bed with you. It'll help keep that water from freezing at night, because your body temperature is obviously going to be warm underneath those blankets. But haven't had a water frozen problem in my van yet. Mind you, I also spend my winters on the west coast of Canada, where we get very mild winters. We may get a week at a maximum minus 10, maybe 2 weeks at the most, and that's it. The winters out there are pretty mild. Wendy Reynolds asks, curious why you and the crew just don't do the snowbirding, blah, 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 doors are open. Being a snowbird means that you're up here in Canada when the weather is nice, and then when the weather turns to garbage, you fly south with the rest of them and stay down there where it's nice and warm and keep your doors open and forget that winter even exists. So we haven't adventured down south yet. There's going to be one of these winters, I'm sure, where it's going to get to me, all the rain on the west coast, and or if we have a bad winter one year where I'm just like, I'm done, and I'm just going to drive south. But as of right now, I really, really love my west coast winters. I love being out there in the backcountry all winter long. Hopefully last winter it snowed, and last winter we couldn't get much backcountry access. So if we get that more and more often, yeah, you never know, guys. We might skip the border, head down south for a little bit of sunshine over the winter season. But as of right now, I really enjoy my winter camping. I love that. There's nothing more beautiful than being out there in the valley in British Columbia, where everything is so lush and green that time of year. It's got that foggy, hazy mist where you can hear the raindrops dripping off the leaves. Oh my gosh. And it makes the most beautiful video. Like, that backcountry is so, it's like living in a movie at that point. You're looking around, everything's got this little layer to it, and this fogginess and this glimmer of moisture, and my heart belongs there. So until the time comes where I stop enjoying my West Coast winters, that'll be the point where I say, see ya, we're gonna go south for the winter. And I'm pretty sure as I start to age, going south is going to be a little bit more appealing because I am a giant wuss for when it comes to cold temperature, and I'm getting worse and worse. And it got chilly the other day and I put my gloves on. And Emmy's like, are you serious? You're wearing gloves today?
Bennett here suggested to insulate the front, back, and side doors.
Those wood panels you see on the top side of my back doors, there's insulation behind that, and those are actually covering the window. If I didn't cover that, there would be a pile of heat loss in the back, and you definitely feel a way bigger breeze from the back. The bottom parts of my door too are also insulated in the door cavity and then covered with a wood panel. And the same thing on my front doors up here.
So the tops there have a half inch layer of pink foam board behind that board, and then the wood's on the top. And then the bottom has all that covering there on the front, which anytime you add a cabinet, the cabinet is going to add a layer of insulation. The board is gonna add a layer of insulation, and there's also some stuff inside of those door cavities as well too.
Besides my van build being insulated on the doors and stuff, I know what they were suggesting, like fully sealing off that door, insulating the side doors, the back door, so you don't let any of this heat out of the doors or any of the cold air in. And if I was winter van lifing in a place that actually got winter, I may go to those kind of extremes. So if I was living in my van in Ontario where you're getting like long 3, 4, 5, 6 month winters and averaging, you know, minus 20 degrees Celsius to minus 40 degrees Celsius. At those scenarios, you're more in a survival living mode, you know, because on those cold days, you need to contain as much heat as you can. At that point, that's survival in van life, where because I escaped that by going to the West Coast, we really don't have those kind of winter extremes. Now that I say that, we're going to get a cold one. You watch every time I open up my mouth and say silly things like that, the West Coast gets dumped with snow or gets super cold. So knock on everything that we don't have a problem. But yeah, so those are scenarios that I think a lot of people will face in a van when they hit a really nasty cold snap in the place they are, and they start to really feel where that cold air is coming in at. It's at that point that you head to the thrift store, you buy some wool blankets, and you cover up the entire back door in a really thick wool blanket or something like that to just keep some of that air from getting inside of here. Those things you guys can figure out on your own as you move forward. Those are extremes that you don't need to think about unless you plan on living in a place that has extreme winters. But at that point, insulate as best you can with what you can afford. And insulating your van is actually not that expensive because that pink foam board stuff, or I use regular white styrofoam on the roof of this thing because that's all I could afford at the time. So up here is 2 half-inch layers of white styrofoam. So it's got a green plastic layer on one side, a foil on the other, and just a traditional white styrofoam in the middle. And it's been in there on my ceiling since I moved into my van, and it works. My walls have a small amount of half-inch pink foam board. And then once you start covering things up, you're adding more and more layers of insulation. Like once you start putting like a board on the roof, now that's another layer of insulation. And then you've got cabinets and things like that and decorations. All that stuff just adds more and more layers to help kind of keep this heat inside. So as for insulating the doors, I'd rather chase weather south before the time ever came to do that. If that starts to happen on the West Coast where we're getting winters where I need to barricade my door shut, that's when I'm going to be a snowbird, for sure.
A psychologist would have a field day with Chrome. Thanks, bro. Thanks. Thanks for that. Michael here suggested to go to Harbor Freight and pick up some moving blankets for the inside of that there, just to contain some of the heat back here, because my front windows is my biggest heat loss in this van. Those windows just literally suck the heat out. So snapping in a moving blanket, Michael, is a really, really great idea. Thanks for that. Is Cruz okay? Cruzy, are you okay, buddy?
Yeah, I'm just not a morning person, Dad.
Hey, you wanna come up here?
People always say you look so sad. I always capture your morning face. Yes, Cruzy's okay.
And Jojo suggested a sleeping bag.
A sleeping bag in a van is a great way to contain your own body heat. And when I first moved into my van many, many years ago, I used to have a Sub-Zero sleeping bag because I also didn't have a really good heating system in my van and there was no insulation in my van at that point in time. But the problem with using a sleeping bag to keep warm at night is I have an animal. And my animal is not going to slide into my sleeping bag with me because he half the time doesn't want to touch me when he sleeps. He likes to sleep in the bottom corner of the bed. So I have to always think about heating the ambient temperature in the van. So if you are traveling with a vehicle, remember heating is super important in the winter because the ambient temperature is something you got to think about for your animal. When I'm in bed underneath my blankets myself, I don't need to leave my heater on at night because I am super, super, super warm. So if I'm finding in the winter time that Cruz is cuddling up to me, that's when I'll turn the heater on inside of my van because Cruzy always sleeps to the bottom corner of my bed and he's down there by my feet. So if my feet are warm, I know he's warm and he usually curls up in a big pile of blankets right over here in the corner. But sleeping bags are not usually a good option if you're traveling with a pet.
Keep up with Speedy says, why not a wood wall between the front and back of the van with a doggy door built into a sliding door or something like that?
Caging off my van will cut back on my living space and also make my swivel chair inactive. And I don't use the swivel seat often, but when company comes over, like we had Joseph over before I left on this big trip, we swiveled the seat around. Joseph sat there, Emmy sat here, I sat here, and we had our morning coffees and stuff together. So having that space open makes my van feel a lot bigger. I myself would not want to secure that thing off, and it would, I think, make the front of my van feel a little bit boxed in, where now I can slide my curtains wide open. It just kind of makes, kind of gives my van an open concept sort of feel. Do you know what I'm saying? So yeah, securing that thing off is definitely something I would not do in my van because having that swivel seat really opens up your living space.
Moon Man, can you show how you mount your axe to the door? I know it's not a winter question, but I've been curious for a while. Okay, so on my door, I have this Fisker's axe, which comes with this little handle to hold the blade in there safely so it doesn't get damaged. So all we did is we took that same handle and screwed it to the door. Literally a couple of screws, bada bang, bada boom. It's a little loose right now, probably could be tightened up, but that's it. Drove some screws through it and boom. We have an axe mounted to the door and it does not really bounce around that much, but obviously you're gonna have to, check on those screws from time to time. Or if you have the means to bolt it all the way through, that could be an idea too as well, but super easy.
Kelvin says, the hooks you have here are easy to change out. He's talking about the hooks on the top of my curtains on that track because they literally just pop right out. Why not run two different curtains for the season instead of doubling up?
Really good idea, but when it comes to storing things in the van, it's a giant pain in the butt to always have a winter box somewhere. Sure, I do have a shop on Vancouver Island, but that really doesn't help me because if I store my winter stuff there and I'm traveling like I am right now and it gets cold out here, then I have to wait to go back to the West Coast to grab my winter box to put it back in the van. Do you know what I mean? So those kind of things need to travel with me at all times. Everything that I need to survive needs to be inside of this space because this is my home. So that's why I figured maybe running a secondary curtain on the inside. It's kind of out of sight. It still looks good on this side with the black, but it has an insulated layer on the inside and the front. That was my thought, was just to keep something in here permanent. You know what I mean? Something that was always there, a little bit more insulated, something that kept the heat out of the back in the summer and also keeps the cool out of here in the winter time. You know, that was my thought. But somebody in my comments the other day suggested this company, and I've seen these things at some of my meetups in some of the Sprinter vans and ProMaster vans, and they have an incredible insulated front window covers. They cover the side windows and they cover the front window, kind of obsoleting the need for a curtain.
There's a company in the US called Adventure Van Company, and I've seen a lot of their blackout window stuff at some of my gatherings I had this summer, but they make a kit for the Ford E-Series. They have a cover for the exact window that I have, the CRL window. It's $140. It's padded, insulated, looks great. And they also have a three-piece kit for the cockpit in the front. So it'll cover my front window and both of my side windows. They're made in the States. They're a little bit on the pricey side, but this is my full-time home, and having something that has dual use, it'll keep the heat out and also keep the heat in, depending on which weather season that I'm in. So this one's an option too, and they look really well built. I might look into this one. So Adventure Van Company, They're pretty cool.
There's definitely a huge DIY thing when it comes to van life, and I know I started there. But as you get deeper and deeper into it, having nicely made pieces like that that just snap in there, they're magnets that go popped up, bada boom, done. They look clean, they look sleek, they look nice from the outside and the inside. And an interesting thing to me about doing something like that is now once my windows are covered, I could leave my curtains open, opening up this space just a little bit more. Sure, my heater may have to work a bit harder to heat that front space, but that also may be awesome to pop those blackout windows in because I cover my side windows with those plastic things anyway, black out my whole front windows, and then when I shut my curtain, it'll add an extra layer. So if I were to ever go that route, I would probably still keep my blackout curtain in here because it smallens my heating space. You know what I mean? So opening that up opens up more square footage that my heater now has to heat. But those things are really awesome. And I noticed that there's a few companies out there that make stuff like that. And the first time I seen one at one of my gatherings, I'm like, oh, what is that? Those are awesome. And he literally just goes, threw it up there and it snapped onto the metal outer edge of the door. Easy peasy, done deal, and looks super sleek.
This is a good question. Joanne asked, what is the safest heat to have? Fire, breathing, etc.
So there's so many options to heat your van. When I first moved into my van 5 years ago, there wasn't as many heating options as there is now. They've simplified things. They have so many cheaper options and expensive options depending on where your budgets are at. So when I started, the big thing on YouTube was get a Mr. Buddy heater, get a Mr. Buddy heater. That was the number one suggested thing when I first started my channel. My comments were riddled in it. So I went out and bought myself a Mr. Buddy heater. And that thing was horrible. The inside of my van felt moist and it felt wet. And because I was new to van life, I was uneducated on the whole aspect of when you have a propane fired heat in your van, that propane takes oxygen from the air inside of the van to burn that heater, which means it's burning the oxygen in the small space that I need to breathe at night, or my dog needs to breathe at night. But I lived in my van for a year with the Mr. Buddy heater because that's all I could afford at the time. It's what I had. It got the job done, but I didn't know any different. So the Buddy heater felt like I was wet camping. Like I woke up in the mornings, my blankets always felt wet, but I kind of thought that's just what van life felt like. It's my first year living in a van. I didn't know any better. And then I upgraded from there to another propane source because I had a big propane bottle in here, a big 20-pound one. So I upgraded from that to the Olympian Wave 3, which is a way better heat source, way better than the Mr. Buddy. So if you're going to go that route, the Olympian Wave 3, I had that in my van for, I think the second year after that, I had had that one in there. Amazing little heater, was great. But at that point, you're in the same scenario. You now have something burning the oxygen inside of your van in order to burn, because in order to make heat, you need combustion of some kind. And so that was the same scenario. But nowadays they have dry air heaters, which maybe they had them back then 5 years ago, but they weren't as known as they are today. And I was never looking into buying like a $1,500 heater because that was way out of my budget at the time. But nowadays they have those knockoff heaters. So I have the Webasto one. I went out and I bought the good one and it's been rocking my van now for a few years and I love it. But they also make cheaper versions of that for just a few hundred bucks. So my suggestion is whatever you're choosing for a heat source, find one that does all the combustion outside. So how those Webasto or the knockoff heaters, whatever you're getting, how they work is it draws oxygen in from outside. It's got a breather vent on the outside, pulls in oxygen into the heater, then combusts the heat, blows the heat inside, and then exhausts it outside. So all the combustion happens outside of your vehicle, not inside of your home. So if you're gonna heat your van, always think about that, because this oxygen in here, you kind of need it. So, I mean, if you can get away from using propane, then by all means do.
Here's someone that suggested to use a candle convection heater and about a YouTube video that someone used their stove to heat their vehicle.
If you're at the point in starting your van life and you can't afford a heating system for your vehicle, I highly suggest to just blanket off everything you can, get a good sleeping bag, and try to heat it yourself. Use your van heater to heat up the inside of the space before you go to bed. Shut your van off. Make sure everything is covered up to contain whatever heat that your vehicle has generated while driving to your sleeping spot, and stay warm in your bed. When it comes to using candles, remember, you need to breathe in here. A candle consumes a fair amount of oxygen in order for that flame to burn. You need that oxygen. Never, ever forget that. Be careful with those situations. It was probably an extreme scenario that you could suffocate. You could. I'm pretty sure one single candle or a couple candles may not be that, but do you really want to take that risk? I personally wouldn't myself. If I was going to light some candles for ambiance, I'd open up a window to make sure that there's a breeze in here. But yeah, guys, be careful with stuff like that. In a pinch or an emergency situation, if you watch my video the other day where I did my big battery upgrade in my van, I showed you a clip of when my whole battery system went out and I needed to light my stove for heat.
Because my camp stove runs on propane, that allows me to have an extra heat source for emergency reasons. But the problem is when it gets cold, propane kind of gels up a little bit and the flame doesn't go high enough. It just literally spits a little bit of flame. But you can use your camp stoves as emergency heat if the scenario came up you needed some emergency heat like I did in that video.
Do not fall asleep with your camp stove on. That's just a seriously bad idea. But in cases of emergency like that day was, I needed to get this ambient temperature up inside of my van. My van was, I thought there was a mechanical problem because it was squealing. Turns out it wasn't. I didn't know. My van's never been in minus 30. So when I started it, it had that squeal. That squeal ended up just being gelled up power steering fluid. And everybody in the winter provinces in Canada were like, yo, Chrome, that's normal. I'm like, oh, I'm from the West Coast. My van's never done that in the winter. So I thought there was a problem. So I never let my van run because I didn't want to wreck my engine. Turns out I could have just let it run. It would have shut up in a minute. In a pinch, you can use that stuff. But please, guys, if you're getting into van life over the winter, think about that kind of stuff when you're approaching it. Do what you can to save the money to pick up some of those other heating sources. Even if it's a Mr. Buddy, it's probably better than lighting your camp stove, which is an open flame, because you never know. But yeah, guys, those Chinese knockoff heaters, if you're on a budget, are a great way. A couple of holes drilled in the floor, a battery for power, and those things will keep you super warm.
In that video, I talked about putting a cover on top of my Max Air fan, and Neil here says, having the roof vent open may allow airflow to come through the rear side window. If you cover the vent over, you may not get the side window airflow that you'd like.
The reason why I brought up possibly getting a cover for my roof vent, I already have this cover for my side window. It's just a board and it just pops over there. It does an okay job about keeping some of that airflow out, but this was just a byproduct piece from when they when Overland Interiors cut that frame on here. But when I was talking about putting a cover on my roof vent, I would only put that cover in place in that extreme scenario that I needed to contain some heat. So if we happen to get a super, super cold night, I would cover that thing up just to kind of ease up on where the air is getting out of here. My roof vent has never been closed except for on that really cold winter day, which is very rare. So if it's minus 5, that roof vent stays open. I leave it open all the time. It's not a big deal. I would rather have that little bit exchange of air in sacrifice of some of that heat. But in that scenario where I need my heat is when I would secure and shut that. And because my heater does all the combustion outside, I don't need to worry about shutting off all my windows. There's tons of oxygen in here for us to survive a 6 or an 8 hour night inside of my van. There's enough little bits of air seeping in from all my leaky door seals anyway. So I would only use that stuff when I really, really, really need it. You know what I mean? If I had an internal propane heat source, you need to keep those things open. You can't shut that in the winter because you need that airflow. If not, you probably might not wake up in the morning.
Dr. Mikey B says, if you don't go all the way to the floor with an insulated curtain, don't bother. Hot air rises and cold air sinks. All the cold air from the front will enter near the floor. That is good advice, my friend. And I've seen multiple comments in there about that. So I stopped my curtain there because it just eased up on the dog hair for Cruz getting up there into the front. And honestly, guys, I never really ever thought about that air coming down in through the bottom. Maybe I need to change that. At least maybe do the inside layer. Remember, I was talking about putting an insulated layer on the inside. Or maybe if I go this route, it'll just help keep all that stuff out of there anyway. I don't know. These are pretty cool and good looking little units. Who knows? I think that there is a definite viable option for sure. And it would cut out the need of sewing up a whole new curtain, which is like a huge deal. And to ask my buddy Joseph to sew me another one, he's going to tell me to kick rocks because that one took him forever. He's going to say, no, dude, sew it yourself. So there's a lot of people in here that are talking about moving blankets, which is a great idea because they're so affordable. Like I hear it here at Princess Auto. I think I got all the red ones at my shop for $5 a piece on sale. And I bought a bunch of them because I knew we were going to just destroy them at the shop once in a while. So I bought like, I don't know, 15 of them. And that's a really great idea. Have I given any thoughts to winterizing my Starlink antenna system? The Starlink dishes have a heating element inside. I literally go into my app and I turn on the heating system. So if I happen to get a big snowfall on my van overnight and my Starlink was deployed the day before, and I'm like, oh, snow, I go in my app and I literally flick on the little switch that says turn on the heating element, and the whole top side of the Starlink will then heat. It'll melt off all the snow or melt off all the ice or whatever's on there that could be frozen. Bada boom, bada bang. Back up with the internet. So yeah, we don't got to really worry about that with Starlink, which is kind of cool. Someone here wants a video about heating the van. I think we've covered some of that in this video, but yeah, maybe we'll do a full video comparing all the ones that I've used. I think we talked about that the other day too. Someone else talked about boarding up that front there, which I'm definitely not going to do. Tony here has a really good suggestion. Try opening your roof vent and turning it on at a low speed, bringing air inwards a little bit. It creates a positive pressure. It pushes air out the cracks and seals around the door, and it mixes your air with some fresh air. I found this works quite well with no drafts. So right now, because I'm heating the inside of my van, I can feel air coming in from outside, maybe because there's negative pressure. Maybe that might work. Bring a tiny little bit of air in here, causing a positive pressure. It may keep all the drafts from sucking in. Ooh, I'm going to try that. Tony, that's a good tip. I'm going to give that one a try. On my app here, these are all the published comments that you guys see. YouTube throws things in a folder here too. So if I go down here to held for review, there's a lot of really great ones in here that YouTube has deemed not good for whatever reason, and they go into a held for review folder. And I clearly don't go through this because you'd have to go through everyone. Like, here's the process. If I want to put these comments public. So this one looks like a nice comment. So if I have to go click approve, now that one's on the page. I'd have to do that with every single one. So I just leave these things in here, but I do scroll through them because there's a lot of really great ones in here. But this is where YouTube throws comments that they think are spam. And if you look, this one says, good video. That is definitely not a spammy comment. I don't get it, YouTube. But anyway, whatever. So let's go through some of these ones here too. Patricia here says, I would love a full winter video and also a review of when weather is too hot. We're going to end this video with that question. Why that question was in my held for review folder, I don't know. That folder's a weird one, but that's where all the bad questions go. Anytime YouTube deems something that could be bad, they're in there, but they happen to just grab other ones too sometimes. So if you ever make a comment on my channel and you don't see it come up posted, you're not blocked. It could have just made it into that folder because, well, things happen. Anyway, let's end this one with that question about winter van life and summer van life. Summer van life is the worst season to live in a van. The worst. You'd never expect that, but it's true. It is way more affordable, way easier to heat your van in the winter than it is to cool it in the summer. Air conditioners need generators, need either a wall plug at a campground or some heck of a solar and power system to run an AC unit for long enough to keep you cool in the summertime.
I have 400 amp hours of SOK power in the back of this. Is that enough to run an air conditioner all day, all night? No. Sure, it may be able to run it for maybe 2, 3, 4 hours. Then what? Then what do we do? So winter van life is way better than summer van life. When you're thinking about getting into a van or thinking about doing some great big expedition trips, worry about that summer heat. Try to find places where you can go that are by the ocean, that are cooler, a bit more breezier, or way up in the mountains, because the higher you go, the cooler it gets, which doesn't make sense. Higher you up, closer to the sun. I don't know, but that's just how it works, I guess. But the higher you are, the cooler it does get in the summer for sure. But when it comes to winter van life, guys, heater is the biggest thing you can do. And find good blankets and stuff. That way, when you're curled up in bed at night, you stay super warm. And it's very rare that I turn my heater on while I sleep at night. Sometimes I might get up because my arms are out of the blanket. I'm like, brr, turn my heater on, set it for 30 minutes so it warms it up. Easy peasy. But it's rare that I leave my heater on all night. I have done it before, but it's sometimes not necessary unless the weather is extremely cold outside. But the great thing about running a Webasto heater or a dry air heater, like the knockoff version one you can buy on Amazon, is the combustion happens outside. So you can let those things run all night long. It's safe, no problems at all. You're inside of your home. Your ambient temperature can be nice and warm for your animals that you're traveling with. So I would highly suggest, if you can afford it, to go with one of those installed heaters. And there's tons of really good companies that make it. There's Webasto, like I have. There's Espar, which is the other big one. And then there's some other really good ones out there. I think there's one called Planar. P-L-A-N-A-R-A-I-R, Planair, Planner. And another one called General Components, which I heard is another good one. And then there's all the real knockoff ones, which are a few hundred bucks. And those ones, you can either get a good one or you can get a bad one. Sometimes I know a lot of people that get Lemons, but some people I've met recently that have one of those knockoff heaters, they've been running them for years. So whatever you choose for a heater, that's on your budget. Get what you can afford. It doesn't matter what it is, but try to find one that does all the combustion outside. Be safe this winter, you guys. And let me know what you guys thought about going through questions like this right after a video like the other one. This could be fun. You know what I mean? This could be fun for a great way to just kind of like sum up that video with a little bit of a Q&A and then move on. I don't want to do this every video, but when you have a video like that, that is such a big topic, like winter van life, I don't know. Let me know. Thanks for watching, you guys.